Before 1992, before I ever touched a computer, I played a lot of games on the NES. And on the NES, one of the most fascinating things to me were the password generators. I am Bisqwit, and in this series we explore how old games generate their passwords. Today we deal with Bomberman. If you are a beginner programmer looking for a challenge, I think that making a Bomberman clone would be a great idea. It's a relatively simple game with lots of interesting challenges. In this series, I will be focusing on the password system, however. The password entry screen in Bomberman looks like this. You enter a password slowly letter by letter, and it never seems to end. The passwords are, in fact, 20 letters long. The next thing to note is that the password alphabet is 16 characters, from A to P. Anyone who has done anything with binary numbers will probably immediately note that this looks like a 4-bit password system. Each character conveys 4 bits of data. These 4-bit units are called nibbles. But the amount of data is 80 bits. What on earth does such a simple game need that kind of capacity for? Let's find out. All of this information comes from a disassembly edit of the game in 2008, which I updated this week when preparing material for this video. The first layer of encryption in the password is a substitution cipher. Letters in a scrambled set of alphabet each correspond to some particular number. In other words, when you are entering a password, you are actually entering numbers, but they look like letters. Here is an example of how the process goes, if you were to do that by hand. Of course, because we are programmers and mathematicians, a more formal and concise definition is called for. You can also see some example C++ code for the encryption and for the decryption. Oh yeah, string constants can be indexed like that. You should already know that if you have watched my videos before. If not, doesn't matter, string constants can be indexed like that. Now you know. Now, I believe that Bomberman is an exceptional NES game in that it uses encryption in passwords, but not the exclusive OR. Instead, all encryption is done with basic arithmetic instructions. Because of that, I took deliberate care to only use decimal numbers in this video, and never use bitwise operators anywhere. They are not needed with Bomberman. When encrypting the password, Bomberman uses this weird algorithm where it subtracts the previously encoded letter from the next one and also uses a constant offset. Here is some example code where the two first layers are processed together. The decryption looks more complex than the encryption, but it really is just the same sequence of operations, but in reverse. All of this can be done manually on a pen and paper, and it is really not that difficult. Now that the password has been successfully decrypted, let's study its structure. The password is composed of 4 groups of 5 nibbles. Each group is a hodgepodge of data. The only common trait is that each group ends in a checksum. Let's study the data in detail. There are a total of 7 nibbles that are dedicated to conveying the score. The score is a 7-digit binary coded decimal number. Each participating nibble represents one of those 7 digits. Why did they put them in such a weird order? I don't really know, but I suspect the reasoning went along the lines of, "We do what we must, because we can." And then there are several power-ups that you can collect while playing. Rather surprisingly, the game saves these in the password. The current stage number is also saved. Surprisingly, it is not a BCD number. And finally, the checksums. As I said before, each group is separately checksummed. The last group also saves a sum of the checksums of the previous groups. Despite the hefty 16 bits allocated to a checksum in the password, it is still relatively easy to come up with a valid password by random experimentation. Partially this is because the checksum is the only defense the game has against broken data. Let's take an even closer look at the data. First, we have the nibbles containing the digits of the score. The game expects to have them in 0 to 9 range. The stage number must be in 1 to 50 range. The maximum range for the bomb flames in the game is 5. It starts at 1. You can have a maximum of 10 bombs in the game. This variable conveys the maximum index in the bomb array, so the value should actually be smaller than 10. And the rest are flags that indicate whether you have the thing or not. This means either 0 or 1. But the game doesn't validate your input. No, wait, let me emphasize that.
The game does not validate user input.
So what happens if you enter unexpected values?
Well, first of all, if you enter numbers 10 to 15 as digits in the score, you get squares and door pieces. This is rather benign and useless, as it actually sorts itself out the instant that you gain score in the game, but you can do it if you so like. Then we have the stage number. The game begins at stage 1 and ends at stage 50. But what happens if you try to enter some other stage? Well, it really depends. Here's what happens if you enter stage 0. At the first glance, it looks like a pretty normal stage. The enemies are typical to the later stages. In fact, the level seems to have pretty much every enemy in the game. The level actually works pretty nicely. The only thing that is actually off is when you try to burn the exit door, the game farts. The bonus item in this stage is a red bomb. I have no idea what that is. If you try to burn it, the game farts again. Now, when you successfully complete stage 0, you get a bonus stage. Curiously, this bonus stage has no enemies at all. Nothing to destroy, nothing to harm you. After you beat the bonus stage, you end up in stage 1. But on the other hand, here's what happens if you try to enter stage 51. The game reboots. My initial guess was that the behavior will be the same for any stage in range 51 to 255, but actually my next random choice, stage 197, did not crash. In conclusion, entering an out-of-range stage number may get you a really difficult game, or crash the game immediately. As I didn't test all stage numbers exhaustively, there is a possibility that something totally unexpected may happen in some stages as the game tries to run random code as enemy AI for non-existing enemies. Next we have the flame power-up. The maximum you can normally acquire in the game is 5, but you can enter 15 by using a custom password. Surprisingly, it seems to work fine, as seen in the previous videos. However, because there is a fixed size memory area reserved for the ongoing explosions, there is at least a theoretical possibility that something goofy may happen if you use larger explosions. I wouldn't rule out the possibility of arbitrary code execution. The number of bombs caps at 10. There is no more room in the game RAM for bombs, but a forged password can still get you 16. This is less interesting than it sounds. Even though I can confirm there is definitely some rogue RAM overwriting going on, in the few hours that I invested in researching this topic, I couldn't find any way to abuse it. The excess bombs are going to be the first ones you place, and once you place them, they will become invisible obstacles that will never explode. Maybe there is a way to cause undefined behavior by doing this, but I couldn't find a way. After that, what remains is the flags. You can enter any value from 1 to 15 for the flags, but basically 0 means don't have, and anything else means have. I also seem to remember that in some situations, a value greater than 1 did not register, but I am not sure about that. So that brings me to the last section in this video, the password generator and decoder. I wrote this one in C++. As you can see, the process is really quite straightforward once you spend some time studying the pattern and the design. I am Bisqwit, stay tuned for the next episode where we go to space.